God bless your bones, America. I'm your host, the Right Reverend David Clark, and I'm more than happy to come in your home today and to share with you the enlightenment of God's everlasting word. It's so good to be here, and I'm so happy that you allow me to come into your home today. Today I have special guests all the way from around the world, worldwide changer, Dr. Pastor Tony Richards. Welcome to Hot Across the Pastor's Desk Ministry.
Thank you, Reverend Clark. It's an honor to be here.
I'm blessed and honored to have you on the show today. God is doing a great work around the world, and I believe that He has chosen you to be a part of that work. You're doing a tremendous work in the area of India, in the area of Asia, and across the globe. And again, I'm just so honored and grateful to have you on the show today. And I know that the Lord has given you a revelation. I know He has given you an assignment. And I know He has given you a mission. Let's start off. I want my audience to know, what is your mission for the local community that you reside?
I thank you. I think one of the things that local communities, states, nations, all need to come together and just realize that, you know what, we're all part of a global experience that God has put together, and that stop trying to do it alone. We need each other. We need to have, the word diversity is used a lot today, but we need to use the word inclusion also. And because with diversity, we can talk about diverse groups, we can talk about diverse people, diverse workforces, diverse cultures, generations. But what we really need to talk about also is how all of this comes together and works together. So my mission is very simple. My mission is to help, whether it be an organization, whether it be a church, whether it be an individual, to understand what God has placed inside of them so that they can go forward and succeed and then turn and help others. And we've got to get away from this me, I. And we've got to come back together and say, you know what? Let's do it together.
Beautiful. Is that part of your worldwide mission?
Yeah, I look at whether it be in Africa or India or Pakistan, Japan, Indonesia, Philippines, South America, United States. We can all learn from each other, and we all can help one another, and we all need each other. And if we understand and embrace the diversity that each one brings to the table, and include that in how we are shaping our ministries, how we're shaping our businesses, how we're shaping our families, how we're shaping our lives, we're going to be a much stronger world and a much stronger people, and people being everyone, than we are right now.
Well, it seems to me that your assignment is to bring solution to this problem community, to this problem world. What is your assignment?
to go in and help individuals and businesses and churches to understand what are those major areas of focus that they need to work on, to strengthen themselves, to strengthen their communities, and then develop a plan of action to get there.
It seems like the world, America, leadership, I mean, Congress shut down is an example of the nation breaking down the community. We see what happened in Europe, Brexit, and how they are now separating from each other. Is unity the answer, solution?
I think the answer is found individually in our attitudes. I think the answer is, you know what, I got to break down the walls. I think that there are too many walls that we need to bring down right now rather than build up walls. I think we need to say, you know what, let's look and embrace the differences rather than say, let's give it lip service, but then let's put up more barriers to hinder us from going forward and understanding each other as a people. There are solutions which I believe that can be attained by cooperating together and not trying to form more division. That worries me. We're a much more global environment, both from a business standpoint and from a church standpoint, from an individual standpoint. We need each other. And globally, we can't exclude ourselves anymore. And if we continue to try to put up walls, we're only hurting ourselves. And you know, I have been in India, and Christians, Hindus, whatever it might be, they're commingling, they're existing together, they're working together. In Africa, we see this in Pakistan, in Japan. And then we come to the United States, and it seems like we've taken a step away from inclusion. We talk a good game, but we don't walk the talk. And that's really a concern of mine for how we can stay strong as a nation. We're a melting pot. We always have been. Everybody has, unless if you're a Native American, everybody came from somewhere else, so you can trace your genealogy. And we have to embrace that and learn from it and grow stronger from it.
Dr. Riches is not only a local pastor, but he is a worldwide leader. And he sees solutions differently because of the culture that he's in. He's able to provide a sign to leadership of plan of action and strategy that will create change. And so Dr. Richard is also an author. He has written many books that bring forth strategy, solutions, plan of actions that will solve your problem. And I believe that everybody should be aware of some of the books that he has composed. Tell us about the first book that you composed about the culture differences and bringing the cultures together.
There's a book that my speaking agent, had called me and asked me if I would send a writing sample, to her, and I did. And then a few weeks later, she asked me if I'd send more. And then a couple weeks later, she asked me again, and I said, "What's this all about?" And she said, "Well, I'll tell you in a little bit." And about a week later, she called and she said, "Have you ever heard of Stephen Covey?" And I said, "Of course, I've heard of Stephen Covey." And she said, "Well, he's putting together an anthology with Brian Tracy and Tom Hopkins and several others, and it's called Bushido Business. Bushido in Japanese means way of the warrior. But the book is how we either individually, as a people, as an organization, as a church, as a government, whatever it might be, how we need to have a warrior's mentality when it comes to things, but lead with a servant's heart. So the book is really about servant leadership. And I was very blessed and honored to be part of this anthology. And that is really the first step that I took into writing and being part of a publication that people can read and people hopefully can draw from and learn from and apply in their everyday life.
Well, from what I can remember, what I read, I felt that was a godsend to what's happening in our world today. When did you write that book?
That would have been about 10 years ago.
My goodness. You need to get this document. It would really change. I'm talking about those who listen to Across the Pastor's Desk. That particular book will give you an answer to the problem that you are experiencing right now. So I encourage you to get that book. Now, it seems like the leadership can't make a decision. And when they can't make a decision based on the president, they can't make a decision based on the economy, the shutdowns, the series of shutdowns, and it has left fear in the hearts of people everywhere. Tell me about your book, Fear Factor, and how it relates to today.
Fear Factor, the acronym for FEAR is Faith Enabling Ability Restored. I had the opportunity to serve under a mentor role, if you will, as a mentee to the late Zig Ziglar. And Zig's philosophy and his acronym for FEAR was Faith Enabling Ability Restored. That's mine. False evidence appearing real is what Zig, how he defined FEAR. And through his teaching and through studying with Zig and through his tapes and books as well, I came to realize that we have a fear, an innate fear in us for things obviously we don't know, we don't understand, but it is up to us to say, you know what, we have to go to the source, a source for us, and for me it's the Bible, to better understand what it is and how it is, the situations, the life situations we're facing. And I'll use an example, a personal example on this. Back on September 11th of 2001, my wife and I were sitting in a doctor's office, and my wife was pregnant, and the doctor came in and said, I have some bad news to tell you. And my wife looked at the doctor and said, I don't know what you're about to tell me, but whatever it is, I know, I have faith that God is going to give us a normal baby. And he said, well, that's good to have faith. He said, however, he said, there's a thickening in the upper left ventricle that's restricting blood supply to the base of the neck, that's restricting air supply to the brain. And he said, a normal baby's heartbeat is about 220 to 225 beats a minute at this stage, and your baby's heartbeat is not getting over 45 beats a minute. So for the remainder of her term, 3 days a week, we were at Children's Hospital in Pittsburgh, and nothing changed. Throughout the rest of the term, same situation, thickening, everything else, and at delivery, when they take the baby and they the nurse takes and washes and cleans them up, I walked over to the nurse, and the nurse looked at me and shook her head. The doctor came in that evening, and he said, we're going to run every test we can in the morning, and then we're going to tell you what looks like we're is going to need to be done. If there are any options, we'll discuss them. But he said, but the prognosis is not good. and the thickening was still there, the restriction of the blood and the air and everything was still there. Heartbeat was very low. And my wife said to me, she said, you know what, let's stay up all night and let's just thank God. Let's not get mad or angry or cry out or demand anything. Let's just thank Him. Because if our, we named our baby Ashley, by the way, and she said, let's just stay up and thank God. We've touched our baby, we've had a chance to smell our baby, to kiss our baby, to hold our baby, to hear our baby, and whatever God has, let's just be thankful for that. So that's what we did. We stayed up all night and we just praised and worshiped and thanked God for the opportunity to hold our baby and to see it. Well, the next day the doctor came in into my wife's room shortly after 11, and he said, now you know the situation we've been facing. And he said, we ran every conceivable test that there is. And he said, what I'm about to tell you, I have absolutely no medical explanation for. Somehow during the night, the thickening dissipated, the blood supply to the base of the neck started flowing normally, the air supply to the brain started flowing normally, the heartbeat started going to 200 beats a minute, 225 beats a minute, and it's holding steady. He said, from all of that happened in the past to now, he said, it shows you have a normal child.
Hallelujah.
So, yes.
Thank you,
yes,
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
So I called the nurse in and I said, I want the name change papers because I want to change her name to Faith.
Wait, and you did that within the same hour?
Right, at that moment. That moment when the doctor told us, I looked at my wife.
You demanded this.
Yes, and I looked at the nurse and I said, I want the name change papers. We're changing her name to Faith. And the reason I did that is because when somebody asks me, how do you know there's a God? Okay, I can clearly tell them this story and know without a shadow of a doubt what God can do if you have faith. And I also know that every time I look at her, she inspires me to go forward. To understand, to look, and to say, no matter what it is you're facing, you can get through this. And to look at my fears very differently. And I started thinking about that and praying about that, and over the course of the next few years, Fear Factor came into being. Fear, the acronym, Faith Enabling Ability Restored. So whatever it is you're going through right now, have faith that God is going to help you through it. I don't know what the situation is. I don't even know how it's going to conclude, but I do know that if you have faith, God will make it and conclude it in a way in which you'll look back and you will say, yes, that God's hand was clearly in this. So that's where Fear Factor came from. It's a short book. Dr. Mike Murdoch from the Wisdom Center in Denton, Texas, said to me one time, when you write a book, write a short book, because most people don't want to read 300-400 pages. But make it practical. And so Fear Factor is less than 50 pages. But in Fear Factor are some stories. There's some ways in which hopefully will encourage you to go forward. And also at the end of the book, there is a life application sheet in which you can take and work through whatever fear you're facing. And it'll help you get through it. So that's Fear Factor.
Well, there is a demand for a solution. And Fear Factor has the message and the answer.
Well, I hope Fear Factor, if people get it, I hope they will look at it, read it, and understand that whatever they're facing, this can help them, can be a resource to help move them through whatever solutions they're seeking.
Wow. So many, well, the environment is so bad. And autism is rising. And if we don't mitigate the environment, then we'll see more situations, medical situations like this. And I want them to read Fear Factor so they will be encouraged to go forward, because there is really a dilemma in our country today in the medical field and in the environment. environmental field, and it creates fear.
It does.
And so fear factor is a urgent. How long ago did you write that?
That book came out about 6 years ago, six, wow. 7 years ago.
Well, yeah. there is an urgent and current need for Fear Factor book. So I encourage everyone to grab that particular book off the shelf or order the book. How could they get the book?
Well, you can go on Amazon.com, or you can order it. You can contact me. You can write me at TonyRichardsSpeaking@gmail.com. You can go on my website at trspeaks.vpweb.com. Or you can call me to order it if you'd like, 701-400-2065.
Well, it is such an urgent need, I believe, right now. Life focus, mm-hmm. It's a tremendous piece of work. Every leader, every pastor should rethink what they are doing. If they're getting the same results, doing the same thing, it's not the answer.
Right.
But if they embrace the solution, the strategy, the plan of action that you have in that particular book, I believe it would transform their life. Why don't you give us some insight on the...
I believe that everybody is a leader. I believe everybody has that quality within them. And in many times in businesses and in churches and in families, you have a designated leader, but we know people who other people gravitate to and really are the leaders in those environments. So what Life Focus is it stems from, I do a Monday through Friday, a nightly 3 to 5 minute motivational piece on Facebook and then on YouTube, and it's called Life Focus, the Life Focus Minute. And I've gotten so much positive feedback from that, from leaders, and then I also work with leaders in of churches, of businesses. I've gotten so much feedback from that what I did is I took a lot of, there's 400 of those Life Focus moments in at the start of this book, and then there is an application section where you can sit down as a leader, whatever issues you're looking at, to strategically plan out the next steps, the next phases to get you to where you want to be. And I think it's important that we do have a plan, that we do understand that our life is not haphazard, that there is a design for our life, but it's up to us to take control of that. And as a leader, you have to take control. And I think, just to make another comment to your thought from earlier, I think in government today, in business today, we have to have strong leaders that are willing to step up and make decisions and say, this is what we need to do for the good of everyone, of the country. Not to say one thing one time and another thing the next time, to bash, to outright lie, to do whatever. I think that is a very, very dangerous form of leadership. And I think leadership starts from within. So wherever you are, whatever you're doing right now, you have that opportunity and that ability to be a leader. And I hope you will take a look and perhaps get Life Focus. Or join me in the evenings to look me up on YouTube. It's TR Speaks. And take a look at some past programs. So that leadership to me is so crucial. Because that's what's feeding our next generation. How are we teaching them? How are we preparing and shaping our future leaders if we're not succinct in what we're doing ourselves?
Absolutely. I'm glad you said that, because the millennials, that generation, need exactly what you are communicating through these three books. They need that.
Yeah, and you see, I hold a little different view. I think the millennials, I think they're being shortchanged in a lot of respects, because I think I'm a boomer, and I think about the '60s when the counter revolution and everything else that we went through, and I think that we forget about that. And I think every generation has its own set of rebellion. Or now I do know that people say, oh, they're not showing up for work, they're not staying, they want more life focus, they want more life work balance, whatever it might be. Well, let's learn from it. Maybe society, maybe the world is changing and evolving to the point where that, instead of fighting it, let's understand it. And maybe over the next 10, 20 years, if that's going to be the norm, let's make sure it's a positive one.
Well, I've heard, and you probably heard the expression, if you know your history, and understand your history, that you will be able to know better your future,
right,
and how to plan and operate. So I recommend the millennials to embrace their history, embrace the senior citizens' mindset, grab as much information that you can grab from their mind and put it all together so you can go forward. Because
yes.
If you don't know your history,
right,
you're going to repeat some things in your life that you didn't plan for.
Yeah, when I work with organizations and people are retiring, I always tell them, get to know them, write it down, know the history. Because that's your past, and what's the saying too? If you don't know your, I'm gonna paraphrase here. If you don't know the history, you're basically condemned to repeat it, and don't make the same mistakes. Learn from them, and that's where I think that opportunity can really come for all generations.
Thank you so much, Pastor Riches, Dr. Riches. We certainly appreciate your vision. We appreciate your theories, your philosophies, what you have transformed into a book, and we believe that it will transfer the life of many who observe your readings and your sayings. Again, we thank you so much for coming and being our guest across the pastor's desk.
Thank you.
So we want you to continue to pray for us, and we'll be praying for you and believing God will order your steps and place you among the people that needs to hear a message from the Lord. So go forward and dominate the world for Christ. For Christ is the answer.
Amen.
To all of the problems today. God bless your bones, America.
You.
I'm your host, the Right Reverend David Clark, and happy to come into your home and share the enlightenment of God's everlasting word through his prophet for such a time as this, Pastor Dr. Tony Richards. God bless your bones, America.